Gary, let's talk about the food sector for 2023. We're still headed into that new year with inflationary pressures, consumer concerns around greedflation. Do you think that sentiment will continue into the new year?
I think it will to some extent, unfortunately. I think it reminds me of that quote from Gandhi that an error doesn't become truth because of multiplied propagation. And I think that we've just heard so many people talk about greedflation and price gouging, et cetera, in the food sector, that I think it's going to be a perception that's not easily shaken. But I do think when more information becomes available to the public, I think those concerns will start to dissipate. We have a couple of studies that have already taken place. We have the Competition Bureau right now looking at this particular accusation or perception that there's greedflation. And I think when people see more of the factual data and information that comes out of that, I think you'll start to see those that perception that there's greedflation. I think it will start to subside to some degree.
The Bank of Canada, as we know, is committed to bring inflation back to its target. They have suggested recently that retail prices are closely tied to commodity prices. Two parts to this, Gary. First off, I guess wondering, will grocers track those prices as they come down? And on the heels of that, wouldn't that then suggest that they have been taking advantage of these prices?
I can tell you that grocers, chain and independent grocers, always are tracking commodity prices very closely. This is an industry that is one predicated on very low margins, much lower than other sectors. And I think that, when you start to see the prices of the commodities come down, you're going to see that reflected at the store as well. I don't think there's really any basis for saying that the grocers are gouging or taking advantage of this situation. There's just no data to support that. And again, listen, I can only speak on behalf of the independent grocers. But those grocers, they're part of those communities that they live in those communities. They buy local, they serve local, they have a symbiotic relationship with their community. The last thing that they want to do is to be pushing the envelope in terms of food prices. They're extremely sensitive to the affordability. And I think when you start to see the inflationary pressures start to come down, as the Bank of Canada is forecasting, I think you're going to see that reflected right across the food sector.
We saw big profits come out of the big grocery store chains, and those dominated the conversations in 2022. You and I have often talked about over-consolidation. Do you think we'll see any changes to that?
No, I mean, and just to repeat again that, the organization I represent, the independent grocers, we have for many years raised concerns about consolidation, both in the retail and in the supplier sectors. But there's no doubt that we have over consolidation in the retail sector. But I don't know how we would, as a country, put the toothpaste back into the tube. I mean, you can start talking about consolidation in a lot of sectors, and how do you deal with that situation? Now, I think what's more important is that is the industry being transparent? Is the industry operating in a way that consolidation doesn't become a source of or a reason for competitive advantages?
Bring us up to speed on the grocery code. Where does that stand, and what is the expectation for this new year?
I don't think there's any doubt now that we're going to have a grocery code of conduct for Canada in 2023. We are extremely close to the finish line on that document, which we'll be releasing for consultation sometime in early 2023. I think I think the best way to describe this to people, and it's going back to your question, Larysa, about the consolidation, it's try to picture yourself driving down the highway, and there's big trucks on the highway, and there's little trucks, and there's passenger cars. So there's no doubt the bigger truck takes up a lot more room than the smaller car on the highway. But can you get rid of the trucks? No, that's not a reasonable solution for, it's just something we can't even in contemplate. And it's the same in the food industry. Can we contemplate getting rid of retail chains? No, the reality is we have a consolidated market. What the grocery code is going to do, and going back to that highway analogy, is to put more guardrails up on the road, more signs of what is acceptable behavior. What are the things that we need to be doing a better job of in the industry? And what are some of the things that we shouldn't be doing as an industry? And I can tell you that one of the positive things that's come out of the process, where we have a few groups right now developing this code of conduct, is there's been a real sense of collaboration. And people at the beginning, we pointing fingers at each other, and has stopped. And we're no longer talking at each other, we're talking to each other. And we're trying to find solutions. And we've been very productive in that process. I think you're going to see that become much broader as this document is shared with the rest of the industry. I think people are going to stop looking for a boogeyman and start talking more to each other. And the more we talk to each other as an industry, because we're so interdependent, we're so interconnected, the better for consumers. And I think that's going to be one of the themes or developments that we're going to see in 2023, is a greater desire for the industry to work together and just build a better industry.
Let's get into the consumer. The Canada Food Price Report at the end of 2022 suggested that we are going to see food price increases anywhere from 5 to 7%. Let's talk about affordability.
I would agree with the estimate that was in the food report. I did read that document. I do think affordability is going to continue to be a concern. I when we were talking previously, I was itemizing some of the issues that have challenged the food industry, and others have as well. I actually think the better way of putting it is, what didn't happen to the food industry last year? And some of those issues haven't gone away. We still have a war in the Ukraine. We still have climate change. We still have high fuel costs, and we're still having product shortages with packaging, and we're still having some labor challenges in the supply chain as a result of COVID. So as long as we have those things with us in the food industry, we are going to continue to see those increases. So I think 5 to 7% is about right. Some of the issues that we have been dealing with have, in terms of the supply chain challenges, have started to be mitigated to some extent. They're not as intense as they were in previous months. So that will be a help. But I do want to be honest with consumers that, yes, you should still expect there will continue to be increases. And I just would add one more thing, is a lot of the issues that arise, for example, in the war in the Ukraine, where it impacts wheat prices and sunflower oil, which is one of the most commonly used oils in the world and is used in a myriad of processed foods. These things impact the food sector more than they would, say, other sectors. You don't need sunflower oil in a hardware store, but you do in the food industry. So I just hope that people do understand that these challenges that we're facing globally do have more of an impact in certain industries, and the food industry would be at the top of the list.
What else will you be watching for 2023? We know that in the past you have mentioned reducing credit card fees.
That is a huge issue that I think we should be watching very, very carefully in 2023. And I would add that this is an issue that affects every single business sector in Canada. Businesses in Canada pay about $10 billion, that's billion with a B, dollars a year in interchange fees. That's a huge amount, and it's simply not sustainable. And in, you know, we've been, you know, I could say, honestly, the independent grocers are leading this fight to have these fees reduced. They have to be brought down. The gap between what a big business in Canada pays for in interchange fees, as opposed to what smaller and medium-sized businesses pay, is simply too large, and it's indefensible. Now, the government has committed to narrow that gap. They've committed that they'll make those fees similar to what the big businesses enjoy. So that's something I think will have a seismic impact on the business community if the government follows through on its commitment. That's a lot of money we're talking about. And if you even cut those fees in half, think about how that would help businesses in this country to continue to stay in business, to continue hiring, continue to invest in their own businesses. But, you know, you have to remember, we've seen a seismic shift in payment patterns from cash to, you know, credit and debit, you know, those kind of purchases. And that's come at the expense of the businesses in this country, particularly the small and medium-sized businesses. So again, I'm crossing my fingers and praying that the government will follow through on this commitment. I do think they're serious about doing this, but I can't overstate the impact that will have on businesses and the ripple down effect it will have on affordability in Canada, particularly in the food sector.